Gary.
I'm Jacob.
We're going for a drive.
...2021 Hyundai Elantra.
Without launch control.
Alright, that's slow.
It's not bad though.
Horsepower and torque.
147 horsepower, 132 pound-feet of torque from a 2-liter 4-cylinder.
And this has a CVT, which is not called a CVT.
Yes, because it's called an IVT because it actually has a chain-driven system rather than a belt-driven system, and it's actually not bad.
Yeah, it actually shifted gears and didn't just ping it off the end right there.
Let's get to the looks because this is an all-new 7th-gen Elantra.
So starting with the side, we've got it all triangled out now.
Yeah, but better than the previous generation of triangles, I think.
Because the previous gen was just triangles on the headlights.
Yeah, which were kind of gross looking.
So this has a cool body line that kind of forms a Z. I think their whole new design style is called parametric design or whatever. But either way, everything does look good and it's totally different than everything else out there.
Yeah, the overall shape is actually pretty good, and whoever made triangles work has actually made triangles work on this version finally.
So then if we go to the front, it's also triangular-ish, and then we got like a lot of angly stuff in the grill.
Yeah, the grill actually looked pretty good on this.
Okay, but then if we look at the daytime running lights, they're not really that impressive. They're kind of just these like weird little lines, but there is an Elantra N coming out. This isn't even the Elantra N line.
Yeah.
And it really works for that model.
Yeah, but on this one, I really don't like these headlights at all, especially from like a 3/4 angle. I feel like the overall headlight shape is a little too awkward because the daytime running light doesn't run with the shape of the headlight.
Yeah, I think the main shape of this car is from the side to get that body line. But then if we also move to the back, we've got a really cool overhang from the trunk that makes it look coupe even though there's a trunk, which is kind of a built-in ducktail spoiler that looks really aggressive from back there.
Yeah, the overall back end is very aggressive looking, and it kind of gives me like Lexus IS vibes with the taillights and stuff.
Well, yeah, because we've got the H-style taillights that go up and down and then all the way across, but just like how sharp that spoiler end is just really cool, and we've got some cool texture in there as well with the body lines.
Yeah, and then we don't really have any fake exhaust, it's just these black kind of squares, so overall it looks pretty good back there.
Yeah, we can't get mad at this exhaust because there's an N Cummings, which is going to be, I think, 275 horsepower, pretty much exactly like the Veloster N.
It'll be the Veloster N drivetrain shoved into here. And there will actually be a manual transmission option in an Elantra, and you can also get an 8-speed DCT.
Okay, now back to the side view. Do you like these wheels?
I do, but I mean, I know the N line's coming and the N's coming, so those are obviously gonna be better, but this works for this.
Yeah, it's all right wheels for a slower version, but what would be the Continental recommended tire?
The Pure Contact LS and the Viking Contact 7 for winter.
And what if you were in the market to buy some Continental tires right now?
Well, if you purchase 4 qualifying Continental Tire passenger tires by November 30th, 2020, you can receive a $70 prepaid gift card. So visit the link in the top comment below the video.
And then in this color, it's kind of hard to get all the lines to pop, but when it does, it's pretty cool. I would ideally like a brushed silver kind of look, because in the presentation they showed us a silver one where like the Z was like really visible.
Yeah, no, overall I think they did a really good job with the generation.
And then looks wise, this compared to a Civic.
I think this kind of...
This kind of has to win because they've updated it like 3 times since the Civic came out.
I don't know if it has to win, but it does look pretty good.
Yeah, then a basic, like a Type R still probably looks better than the Elantra N that's going to come out.
Probably.
Yeah.
But the Elantra N may have better wheels because I really like Hyundai's wheel design sometimes.
So if you're done liking how the car looks, we should probably get to all the cool features this has.
Starting with this aircraft-inspired cockpit.
Yeah, that's what they told us. Okay. It kind of makes sense. You've got like your panel here, and you got this panel that sticks out. We've also got this panel on the left, which I thought was gonna like start up and be something cool, but I think it's just a sticker.
Yeah, spoiler alert, that doesn't do anything, which is probably the worst part of this entire interior for me, just because it's this blank, gloss black section with a thing that doesn't do anything.
But it looks cool. It really ties together all the screens, and maybe in a faster model, they'll have a use for it.
Yeah, because I feel like they didn't have a choice but to do that.
And then we've got the double 10.25-inch screens, which actually work pretty well. Our infotainment screen is pretty much the regular new Hyundai-style screen, so we've got Apple CarPlay, Android Auto, and it is full widescreen.
And it's currently not wireless Android Auto, Apple CarPlay if you get a model with navigation, but apparently that is being added because if you get one without navigation, you do have wireless Android Auto, Apple CarPlay.
And then the rest of the infotainment, it can rewind SiriusXM satellite radio stations. It's got those cool bulb things, But when you look at all the icons, they all kind of blend together. I found this one thing on Reddit that I stole from someone. I don't know who it was. Sorry, I can't give you credit. But it showed all the Google logos and how they were all different and now they're all the same. That's what it feels like trying to read these icons.
Yes, and those Google logos are the worst now, and I can't find anything anymore. So just like this, I totally agree.
But then if we move on to our gauge cluster, sometimes we've had Hyundais in the past that had really laggy gauges and transitions. This is actually all really fast, really smooth. I see nothing wrong with it.
Yeah, I think they sped up the transition animation, and we will take full credit for that because we complained about it previously. Yeah. So you're welcome, everybody. But overall, this entire gauge cluster is really impressive, and you don't really get anything like that in this segment.
So if we look at our cool designs, we've got Sport, Smart, and Normal. Then there's also a secret mode that if we go through our infotainment, we can find that. And it's got the cubes similar to what all the setup icons are.
It's such a weird mode. Like, I can't see anyone ever practically using that, but it's almost like a Tesla, like, Easter egg kind of thing.
And all the graphics in here, very high res, everything's smooth. And then the controls are pretty much the exact same as every other Hyundai Kia Genesis. On the steering wheel to control stuff there.
And to control our infotainment, we still do have a bunch of hard buttons, which is really nice. Unfortunately, we don't have a tuning knob, but we do have tuning buttons, so at least there's that. And then we also have physical controls for all of our climate, which is really nice.
Yeah, we got a volume knob in the middle. We can still go to our phone projection by pressing the star button. And it's nice because unlike the Sonata, we don't have any like LCD touch buttons on the side.
Yeah, exactly. We do have some bezels here, but I feel like we can't really avoid that here.
That's fine. I don't even mind bezels.
Bezels are the worst.
No, they're not.
They are the
worst.
For
like cars like this, like what do you
expect? For cars like this, I'm saying that's why it's fine.
And we also have ambient lighting in this Elantra, which is pretty nice because I don't think many cars in this segment have that.
Yeah, some do, but it's usually not very impressive. This one's pretty decent.
Yeah, you can like customize the colors or have it go to your drive mode. And there's a lot of other cool stuff in the interior that you are going to talk about right now.
Interior! Before we talk about the interior, launch.
It shifts.
I like that. I like that about the CVT, but it is kind of loud, especially in the upper RPMs.
But we don't have any pumped in audio in this, which is nice because we don't like that stuff anyways.
Exactly, and you can't turn it on or off, it's just none. Sitting from here, much more comfortable. I feel like it's a lot more open from here rather than in the passenger seat.
Yeah, well, we've got this bar here that makes it kind of cockpity, and I guess the person who buys the car is the one who's driving it, so it makes sense. But the way this is all white, it really ties in really nicely. And one of the things that I really like is see how the bottom part is white? It matches the line here on your steering wheel if you line it up perfectly, and this part at the top is dark.
It
matches the top buttons.
And I like that they use this weird texture on the steering wheel, which they also used around the shifter. It's cool, and I like it because it's not gloss black, because we actually do have quite a bit of gloss black, which is definitely gross. And also down here, we have a wireless charger, which you can see vents for so that it cools your phone so that it charges a little bit faster, which is always very appreciated.
I guess everyone did that because phones are just like overheating by getting charged. Okay, then if we move back, we've got a cup holder area, and it is one of my favorite cup holders of the year because you can pull this out if the cup's too deep and then switch it so it sits higher up.
And it's kind of funny because then switch is upside down. It's hard to read, but at least you know exactly what's going on.
It's perfect. It's one of those things that you read once and then you never have to read it again.
That is true. Since we're talking about cups, what about visors?
I think they'll pass.
I think so.
3, 2, 1.
Yes. Great job.
Full pass. And then how about these materials?
Materials are really cool, especially on the door panels. I get like jean vibes from this.
Yeah, it's on the back of the seats too, which I wouldn't expect on the back of the seats. I'd expect like hard black plastic or something. I really, really like this. And then we've got white seats, which I also really, really like. They are heated.
And they're really comfortable as well. There is some cheapness going on the door panels and stuff like that, but that's kind of where you would expect it.
It's totally fine.
Yeah, exactly. It's really nice. The steering wheel also feels nice. The buttons on the steering wheel are also really nice. Like, no real issues with material and overall interior quality.
I don't know if they needed to make the buttons piano black.
Yeah.
And then the turn stocks are piano black, but they are nice and textured. They're like from a more luxurious Hyundai.
And our actual shifter looks really nice and functions normally, which is always awesome. And then if you put it into the left into sport shifting mode, it'll actually simulate the gears really quickly, like faster than most automatic transmissions. Like, that's pretty cool actually for an IVT.
Yeah, maybe it's easier to simulate because they aren't real gears.
Yeah, probably.
Okay, and then they also told us that they made this car a little bit longer, which helps for backseat room. And they're kind of right because this has taxi cab levels of backseat room.
Yeah, for a compact car, I am shockingly comfortable back there at 6'1.5".
Don't forget guys, we drive all types of cars, cheap ones, expensive ones, luxury, normal. Subscribe for more videos.
Subscribe! And now finally for the last thing people probably care about in this segment, how does this actually drive? I'm gonna floor it. Response pretty quickly actually. It's got just enough power, like it's totally acceptable. You're not gonna be upset unless you're like merging on the highway, then it's probably a little bit slow.
But they are going to offer an Elantra N line than an Elantra N. So if you need more power for this size vehicle, it's coming.
Exactly. But speaking of merging onto the highway, we also have Highway Driving Assist, which is awesome and probably the best in this segment by far.
And normal lane keep and radar cruise control, and the radar blends into the grille.
Yeah, like very well. And in terms of the suspension, it's really comfortable. This car handles actually surprisingly well. I didn't expect it to do as well as it does. We're obviously not at Cliche Corner, but we're at Cliche Kanata Corner because we're just outside of Ottawa.
Yeah, it handles fine, but it's just not exciting. So after you push it once, you're like, hey, performed better than I thought it would. But yeah. I also have no desire to do anything sporty after that.
Exactly. We don't have a multi-link rear suspension. We have a torsion beam. Overall, in something like this, you're probably more worried about comfort, and the suspension is really comfortable.
Man, I think these seats help with the comfort a lot too, because we were in a luxury car this week too, and I actually think these seats are more comfortable than that $200,000 luxury car.
Yeah, I kind of have a little bit of that thought as well. And since we are on these turns, steering is totally normal, and if you change your drive modes, it does have an impact on the lightness of the steering. I would just leave this thing in normal all the time.
Yeah, unless you want to change the gauges, which you could also just have them set at that gauge level. You don't have to link them to your drive mode.
Yeah, just put them to those cube gauges. And
yeah.
They're so weird.
Yeah, just confuse everyone you pick up when you're driving this for Uber.
Yeah, including yourself, I guess.
And lastly, this only has a reverse camera, no 360 camera.
Yeah, which, again, I wouldn't expect at this price.
Dude,
it's a compact.
I mean,
let's get to the price. $25,559.
Canadian.
And this is the ultimate package. So not quite fully loaded, but pretty damn close to it because there are like hybrid variants and stuff like that.
And you can get a manual transmission in this too on like a lower model. They said like the take rate is like only 3% when you're like,
That's all of Quebec.
At least they're offering it, right?
Yes, exactly.
So overall, Elantra, we finally got to drive it after doing that virtual review a couple months ago. Did it live up to what we thought it'd be?
I think so.
It's pretty much exactly what I expected, but I just don't like that the paint colors don't pop as much as I think they could if they used something that was like more matte.
Just because of that one image you saw of this in gray matte.
Yeah, yeah.
So let us know what you guys think of the all-new Elantra. Would you take this over a Civic, over a Corolla, over a Kia Forte?
Let us know, and then also check out the Sonata N-Line video, which we should be releasing at the exact same time as this.
Yeah, watch that video.